so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know the saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. I'm so glad I've learned to trust Him.
Amen.
Precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that Thou art with me. 'Twill be with me till the end.
Welcome to segment 10 of our Sin Nature study. The title of this segment is The New Walk in Christ. This phase of the Christian life has been much misunderstood by God's people. We treat God as though He were a medicine chest. When we realize our lack of some spiritual quality, such as patience, for example, we think we can go and ask for a little patience pill, and God will provide it in that way. If it is a little more holiness in our life we need, we think we can pull down a certain bottle that will have holiness in it. The same is true with regard to humility and our lack of love. We seem to think we can go to God and get these as we would pills from a medicine cabinet. This, we seem to think, takes care of us for a little while until we find ourselves in need of these spiritual pills again. But God does not dispense the various graces. He has only one gift for us, and that gift is the Lord Jesus Christ Himself. He is our life, and He lives in us. Consequently, if it is patience I need, God does not give me a little patience, but He teaches me to turn to Christ and let Him be the patience in me. If it is humility I need, then I turn to Jesus, recognizing that He is the vine and I am the branch, and the life is in Him. Humility lies in Him and is expressed only to the degree that Christ is permitted by me to live His life in me. We read in 1 John chapter 5, verses 11 and 12, how that Christ is our eternal life. We have used this verse with unsaved people to lead them to a saving knowledge of Christ But for some reason, we have overlooked the fact that this verse is teaching us that Christ is our life. We have accepted him as our Savior, one who saves us from hell, and who has our names written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. But for some reason, we have not accepted him as our life itself. We have given him no chance to live his life in us. We want his life for eternity, so far as guaranteeing us heaven and escape from hell is concerned. But we have failed to realize that he is our life here and now if we are going to live victoriously. Here are the verses in question. And this is the record, that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. We see then that if we lack humility or meekness or love, these cannot come as separate graces, but as the expression of the life of Christ within us. Now notice very carefully that Romans 8 verse 4 does not say that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled by us, but rather it says that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us. The scripture does not say that he is going to give us a little power in order to fulfill his will, but the righteousness of the law will be fulfilled in us by him who lives in us. Our responsibility in this case is to let him live his life in us. So then, God gives us only one gift, and that gift is the Lord Jesus. That is what Paul meant when he said in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, "Nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me." In agreement with this, Romans chapter 6, verse 23 says, "The gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ." We have eternal life only as we have Christ himself. Paul, in his letter to the Colossians, wrote that Christ is our life. Chapter 3, verse 4. That helps explain Exodus chapter 3, verse 14. Where God said to Moses, "I am hath sent thee." It is as if God said, "I am the life, and whatever you need, Moses, that is what I'm going to be for you." Now, as to the outworking of this life, we must realize that we take one step at a time. That is where this word walk begins to take on real significance to us. That is the way small children learn. They take the first step, then they stop and think, and finally take a second step. After a while, they can walk a little better, and soon they begin to run. The dictionary definition for the word walk is to advance by steps, lifting one foot while the other is securely on the ground. This is different from running. When a person runs, both feet are in the air part of the time. But in walking, we never take another step until we have securely planted one foot on solid ground. Then we take the next step. It is well to keep this in mind as we discuss this matter of walking and the spiritual life. Now, the word walk can also be defined to mean the pursuing of a course of life, or the manner in which one conducts himself. It is a word which describes behavior, and it is with this meaning that the word is employed quite consistently in the Bible. The believer's walk includes the whole round of his activities as an individual. There is a related Bible meaning which is also very vital. Walk also means the keeping in step with another, with submission of heart to that other, who is the Holy Spirit. Some of the positive uses of the word walk are to be found in these different scriptures. Walk in the newness of life, Romans chapter 6, verse 4. Walk in honesty, Romans chapter 13, verse 13. Walk by faith, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. Walk in love, Ephesians 5, verse 2. Walk in wisdom, Colossians chapter 4, verse 5. Walk in truth, 2 John, verse 4. And in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, we are told we should walk in good works. We have already seen that Romans chapter 8, verse 4 tells us to walk after the Spirit. There are also some passages that tell us how we are not to walk, such as Romans chapter 8, verse 4, where we are told not to walk after the flesh. We learn from 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 3, that we are not to walk as men, that is, after the manner of unsaved men. We further learn that we are not to walk in craftiness, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 2. Walk not by sight, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. Walk not in the vanity of the mind, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17. And walk not disorderly, 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 6. The word walk carries with it the idea of activity. In several places, it is translated go. We see from this that to walk does not even remotely signify idleness. A newly born child has to be carried. Later on, it learns to walk. As the child progresses in age and strength and physical development, it learns to run. It is true, such children stumble, but they pick up their feet and go again and are seemingly not discouraged with their stumbling. Just so it is, we learn to walk with the Lord. Later, we find that we are to run the race. But there cannot be any running until we first learn to walk. Keep in mind that walking in the spiritual sense is a walk of faith. We must not become discouraged if we do not walk at first as mature Christians or are not able to run the race as we should. We grow in the grace and in the knowledge of our Savior, Jesus Christ. It may be that we see some desirable goal in the spiritual life. How do we attain to it? We depend upon the Holy Spirit to lead us step by step and give us the power to move in the right direction. We have noted that this is a step of faith, for God wants us to learn to trust Him. Yet there are among God's people those who feel they cannot walk without the law. They are afraid that if they do not have the law hanging over their heads, they will be led into sin. Like a child learning to walk, they are afraid to turn loose of what they are holding on to. But we will never walk easily or well in that manner. As we step out in faith on God, we will find out that the Holy Spirit gives us new joy and vigor and inspiration to take the second and the third and the successive steps that are needed. The Spirit will not lead us into sin, but victory. So we must let go and trust Him completely. Perhaps it is a financial matter that is facing us. Perhaps we always have to see the money on the barrelhead, as we say. We will not take a step with God until full provision financially has been made. God says, in that case, to plant our feet firmly in Him and raise one foot by faith, step forward, then raise the next foot and step forward. How easy it really is. It is a walk for which God makes constant provision. This walk in faith is a brand new way, as we read in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. We are new creatures in Christ Jesus. As new creatures in Christ Jesus, we find, according to verse 14, that the love of Christ constraineth us. There is something about that inner love that God has put in our hearts that causes us to step forward one step at a time, following Him. You see, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. It is a new life entirely, with new ventures quite different from the old life. To live the Christian life is not a case of trying, but a case of trusting. It is not a matter of struggling, but of resting in Christ. It is a walk in the Spirit, Galatians chapter 5, verse 17. It is a life characterized by what Paul describes as, the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. We find that there are things that we want to do, but we cannot do them. We also find that the flesh wants us to do things that we cannot do. Why? The Spirit is striving against the flesh, and He seeks to persuade us not to do the things of the flesh any longer. Our walk becomes a walk in the Spirit. The Christian life is not only a changed life, it is an exchanged life. It is a substituted life. Christ was our substitute to pay for our sins and to obtain forgiveness for us. But now we find that Christ's life is the substitute for our life. He has become our life and lives within us. As this truth grips you, you will never tire of it. It is something you will lean on and live in day after day. That is why we noted previously that this is not a life of trying, but of trusting. He takes our feet and causes them to walk forward. This is a life of reproduction. Through regeneration, we are made new, but through reproduction, the life of Christ works in us. That is why Paul says in Galatians chapter 4, verse 19, "My little children, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you." It is the substitutionary life. This is a life not of work, but of walking. What we mean by that can be illustrated by the law of gravity. If I throw an object in the air, it falls. That is characteristic of all things on the earth. They are attracted back to the earth. But if I throw an object in the air and put my hand underneath it, I stop its fall. This means that another law, more powerful than the law of gravity, has intervened to counteract it. That is the way God works in us. He lives in us and overcomes in us and walks in us. Walking, then, is not our working, but being in subjection to the Holy Spirit who indwells us. And as we have noted before, the righteousness of the law will be fulfilled in us, not by us, because the Holy Spirit has made his abode in our hearts. We have seen that salvation in Christ includes victory over sin. The first step in making this victory effective in our daily experience is coming to know that we are identified with Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection. On this we reckon, count it true, and regard it as a fact in our daily experience. Following this, we are to completely yield our bodies with all their various members to the Lord. We are then to walk in the power of the Holy Spirit, and as we walk in the Spirit, we will find that we do not fulfill the desires of the flesh nature. However, with most of us, if not all of us, we find it hard to believe that we can live victoriously without the law to lean on. Like a child learning to walk, we want something to hold on to. It is hard for us to let go and let God live in us in Christ. Like Paul, we have to be brought to the end of ourselves and made to realize that Christ living in us and the power of the Holy Spirit is all we need. When we walk in him, we are freed from the law of sin and death. The righteousness of the law is fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Holy Spirit. Will you not turn to Jesus now for this victory? This is part of his great salvation for you. Come to him by faith now, just as you first came to him for salvation. This concludes the present Sin Nature study series. It was based on a book titled Victory, Imparted and Tested, written by Theodore Epp. Thank you for watching.